talking about this one mythological woman, you know, who went through all the horrible things that most women are undergoing even today. Okay, but then, you know, how she came out of it, or rather, how she faced the challenge, and how she was able to deal with the challenges that came in her life, are the things that we're going to be talking. My narration is going to be more or less uninterrupted, unless you have something to add. And at the end of it, just we will go through the lady again with the help of all the empowerment lists that you give. Okay, and the lady of the day happens to be Draupadi from Mahabharata. And as I told you earlier, I'm going to spend possibly an hour on this, an hour, all of us together, it's not just me. Okay, so who was this lady? You know, she was born of the fire. And this fire is a metaphor. See, now you're all grown up. It's not just the story which is going to appeal to you. You're going to understand what life means. And this fire is symbolic of her entire life. And what is fire capable of? It can burn you down. It can cook your food. It can keep you warm. It can singe you. It can make you squirm. It can destroy you. It can make you. Yes? Aren't all women like that? Okay, so we are talking about this lady who was born of fire by the special prayers of her father. Somebody was saying equations with men. So men have, women have always been trying to work out equations with men. Because men think that women are instruments of their successes, their dreams, their determinations, and their future. So in the case of Draupadi, you find the Draupada, the father of Draupadi, the king of Pachala, was childless for a long time, and then he had one child who was all biologically wrong. She couldn't. I mean, it so happened that you need to know a little about Draupada before you learn about Draupada. There was this man who went to school with Drona. They went to the same Gurukula. The two of them were great friends. And there was a lot of give and take, like amongst all friends. And when the two of them part ways, Drona goes on to become a teacher, the guru of the Kuru princes. And you find that Draupada becomes the king of Panchala. And then both of them lead their own lives. And then one fine day, you find that Drona goes on to marry Kripi. He has a son called Ashwatthama. And he prefers to live in the poverty of a Brahmin's wife. And he finds that he is not able to take care of his children. It's not like the teachers of today who get NEFT payment on the first week of the every month. No. This man would only get his Guru Dakshina at the end of training all the 105 people. Students. So he did not ask for any advance, which meant that his child was drinking, you know, rice flour mixed with water, and it was passed off as milk. The wife gets a little bugged with this man. For her husband, she says, you should do something about it. So if your ego is so strong, if you think that you can't go and ask your employers for your payment, why don't you go to your friend? You always talk so highly about Draupada. Go to him. Check whether he can do something about it. And Drona, with a lot of hesitation, goes to Draupada. And then he tells Draupada, you know, and then when he goes there, I think all of us, when you were students, life was very different. Now when you work in an office, you find that, you know, people who you think are friends are not really friends, and somebody who you thought was not really a great person happens to help you out. Same thing happens in the case of Drona. This man looks through him. He says, look, you know, who am I? I am the king and you are just a Brahmin. And now you can't, you know, we can't be on equal status. And immediately Droda gets very offended. He says, you're saying all this just because you're a king? I'll show you who you are. And he goes back and trains Arjuna and the Kuru princes to defeat Draupadi. Okay. And when Draupadi is defeated, he draws a line over the map of Panchala and he says, we'll divide it into Panchala and Kampilya. Now, I am the king of Panchala. I'll give you half the kingdom. Take it. Look at it. It's a gesture of, what shall we say, to show that don't mess with me. That was the message of Droda. But what a normal person would have done is probably, you know, seethed, felt angry and would have just settled the matter. But Draupadi was not somebody like that. He wanted to settle scores with Droda. And how so? Because he didn't have a son either. And Ashwatthama is the son, and Drona very happily says, you can also have my son. You know, my son is like your son. So he says, no, I'll have children of my own. So he has this yajna. He prays for a son actually. He has a Drishtadyumna. But he is also offered a daughter. She's a compulsory free gift along with Drishtadyumna. Now, do you see, what was the status of Draupadi? We are hearing about so many cases of feticide, where children, girl babies are destroyed even as they are born. Are you getting the idea? You find that Draupadi was one such unwanted child, born of a king, born out of the fire, a sacrificial fire, but, you know, she was an unwanted package. It's like when you buy a shampoo, they give you a soap which you don't really use, but you don't want to leave it behind because it's anyway free. Are you getting the idea? So you find that life begins like that for Draupadi. Here I'm not trying to, you know, throw the light on Draupadi as a bad person, good person, nothing. What we are going to do is, Vyasa wrote the Mahabharata easily a 5,000 years ago. And it has been written and rewritten, and they made movies, and you know, they made a lot of plays and a lot of serials and so many things, like comic books and things like that, on the Mahabharata. And the story is more or less the same, small variations here and there. But look at why and how the Mahabharata becomes so relevant. See, and when you actually look at one character like Draupadi, you have to know the whole story to understand. So indirectly, you have to know the Mahabharata, knowing what you do. Are you getting the point? So are you also getting the drift of what I'm trying to say? So Draupadi was not somebody in the books long, long ago. She is every one of us. Questions that were risen in families when girls were born. Especially as the first child, when it was expected to be the son, and so on and so forth. And you find that this child grows up. And in the meanwhile, you find our man, who is he? Draupadi, he says, okay, now I've got this freebie, I will utilize her. He also promises, now that this girl has come, I will make sure that her husband is Arjuna, child marriage. She doesn't get married as a baby, but the father decides, who has the freedom? He has already decided who she is going to marry. And why? Not because his daughter is going to be happy, not because she is going to have a grand life in Hastinapura, but because he wanted to bear the lion in its own den. He wanted to get rid of Drona. Who was Drona's priya shishya? Arjuna. And the best slap comes from him, then Drona is going to be settled. Are you getting the idea?
Yes.
Look at the idea of this father, the king. And who is Draupadi? She is a princess. And she is not an ordinary princess. She is the gift of the gods. And look how she is manipulated. Okay. So the point that I'm trying to make through the story is, it's not about, empowerment is not something about something that other people will give it to you as a gift, wrapped, so that, you know, I want independence, I want freedom, I want confidence, I want care. Nobody is going to give you anything. You're going to get a raw deal in life. But what you are going to do out of it is what is going to empower you. It's like life gives you a lemon, makes lemonade out of it. Don't say, what am I going to do with it? If you're going to start asking questions like, what am I going to do? Then you will never do anything. But if you start doing, you start. So does Draupadi's life continue like this? Is she just going to be a pawn in her father's life? No, life moves on for her. As she grows up, there's this Vayamvara which is in there. And Draupada makes sure that he has the toughest archery game so that he gets only Arjuna to marry Draupadi. Because he knows he is one of the best ever archers that a country can ever have. So the thing is arranged. But in the meanwhile, you know the parallel story. These Pandavas have been sent to the Lakshagriha. They've been burned down. Or Hastinapura thinks that they have been burned down. Whereas these guys have actually escaped. Okay. And then you find that the killing of Bakasura happens. Bhima marries Hidimba. The five Pandavas are there in the guise of a Brahmana. All of the story you know. And when the Swayamvaram was arranged. What kind of a Swayamvaram is this? What is the meaning of a Swayamvaram? The girl can choose the vara she wants. Let us say, Draupadi liked some Lallu Panju somewhere in the 4th street of Panchala. Did she have an option to marry him? Are you getting the thing? See, in the name of all this, I always feel that when they say that girls should dress up very nicely, alankara is important and they should do this and that, I always feel this is my personal feeling. This is, why should you cater to anyone? Why can't, like, let us say I don't expect guests at home today, I have nothing to do today. So don't I have the right to dress up well and watch TV or read a book? You don't have to do it for other people. Are you getting the point? So the Swayamvaram is thick. We are talking only of Draupadi Swayamvara, but every Swayamvara is like that only. They'll have some political agenda in mind. See, I find that most of you are young people. You know, it's not that parents manipulate or anything. They have some aim and they will try to channelize the girl's idea through these things. And I have deliberately taken the example of a princess to show that a princess is definitely far more empowered than any one of us here. So if she has to go through all this rubbish, so where do you stand? This is the next question. So the Swayamvara happens. As usual, you know, Arjuna is incognito, all the guys come, everyone doesn't succeed. And Arjuna succeeds in the guise of a Brahmana. And naturally, Draupada is very, very upset because he doesn't know the truth. And the marriage doesn't take place, even worse. You know, she's taken, like, she's been chosen as the bride of this Brahmana. And Vyasa comes and says, no, he happens to be Arjuna. Krishna gives endorsement, attestation, yes, this man is Arjuna. But then Arjuna is not someone who will marry without his mother's permission. So he goes home and he says, Amma, see who, what is the phala of today's bhikshatan? Because they have to go, as Brahmanas, they have to go for bhikshatan. And then he says, she says, okay, divide it equally amongst all of you. And it's only later that she realizes she's talking about this woman and not the usual things that they get every day. And here, you have to observe another thing. The moment she sees this, as a woman, Kunti understands that she is, you know, she shouldn't be saying what she has said. And she says, oh, I'm sorry, I mean, I didn't mean it that way. So Arjuna, go ahead and marry Draupadi. Yudhishthira, another man. He says, no, mother's words, you know, once they are spilled out of her lips, have to be carried out. You know, it doesn't matter if it's going to cause a lot of inconvenience, embarrassment, and terrible feelings to another woman. Who cares? We know the story of Draupadi so well. I have noticed that, you know, when I went to tell stories to small children, they so easily accepted the fact that, you know, she married 5 men. For them, Draupadi is, oh, is she the one who married all the 5 Pandavas? That's all. But as you grow up, you're all young women, you know what it means. You know, we have temples for Draupadi. Especially in Kerala, you have quite a few temples for Draupadi. You know, and we do all of this, but just imagine if she were a woman like you, and you're put through this kind of an ordeal, how are you going to go through it? But she goes through it. And of course there are a lot of karmic reasons and stuff like that, saying that she was destined to marry 5 guys, so she married. That's another thing. Destiny is another thing. 100 things can happen because of destiny. But what you go through during the destiny is what you have gone through. That's the reality, right? Anything for that matter. Isn't it? Don't we all go through those? It's the emotions. So this lady goes through these 5 marriages. The brothers arrange amongst themselves. Look, we make rules saying that when I'm with her, you should not be with her, and so on and so on. Which sounds, you know, because we know the story so well, we know it's the normal aspect of Mahabharata. It's not a normal aspect in a woman's life. She can't be taken again and again and legally. Are you getting the idea? And that's exactly what happens. And you will be very surprised to know, to this day in India, in North, in Haryana, the Jat community still has these practices. You know what we say? When a woman is widowed, of course, they wait for her to get widowed. And then they say she automatically has to take the husband's brother as her husband. This husband can be 5 years old, 3 years old, she can be 80 years old, whatever. And why do they do that? So that the property does not go out. And all the brothers will be very eager to marry this widow, because that share of property will come to her. We have such practices today, 2017. It just happens automatically. And you tell me, how are these women any different from Draupadi? You have such a practice down south in Kerala. Of course, they don't marry widows. You find that the Nambudiri Brahmins, you know, the ones who are in charge of these Padmanabha temples and so on and so forth, these men are allowed to take 2 wives. One, a Brahmin wife, for Adhyatmika purposes. And then for Laukika purposes, he can take a Nayar wife. And this is happening till today. And then you always find that when girls of the Nayar community have to get married, it's always a question mark, especially when it's an arranged marriage. Okay, so you find that this kind of a situation is happening even in Draupadi's life. And life goes on. She marries. She stays with her husband, her husband's in-law. Life goes on, and at some point of time, you find that Dhritarashtra realizes they are given Indraprastha, that actually the Kandava Vana is given to him, and it is converted into Indraprastha. And Indraprastha is this lovely city which has been created by the brothers with the help of none but our Maya. You know, so you find that he has become, city is there, everything seems to be in order, everything seems to be perfect. But at the end of it all, you find that there always has to be a turning point in the story. Before I turn the point in the story, I just want to know, is it okay, this tempo and this narration? Yeah. If you're feeling bored, what you can do is, we can just break for some conversation and then get back. What do you say? Or shall I continue? Continue? Okay. From everyone? Okay, she doesn't get counted because she went out for a conversation. Okay, anyway. No, but feel free, because this is not a classroom and I'm not trying to finish poems. Okay. So what is the turning point?
I could not.
Yeah, that's why I brought in the example of the jab community, and as and when it is necessary, I will definitely do it. Okay, yeah. So what I'm actually doing is, I'm comparing that with Judy. That's exactly what I'm doing. That's why I brought in, if you remember, just to say that I have been doing what she has asked me to do. We were talking about this bhrunahatya, that is fetal, in feticide. Then I spoke to you about the swayamvara. What does it actually mean? And now I am speaking about the concept of polyandry. Why does a woman take more than one husband? Even today, it's because of once again properties. The man's agenda, which is more important. Are you able to see? I think when I'm narrating the story, it kind of merges, so you're not able to see the difference. That's okay. That can happen. But yeah, this is the way it's going to be. So you find, what is the turning point of the story? You find that the cousins are invited. The Kuru brothers are invited to Indraprastha, and they are awestruck by the beautiful architecture there. And you find that Duryodhana stumbles over a pool of water thinking that it's flowing. And as fate would have it, Draupadi just laughs. And she also remarks saying that the son of a blind man is also blind. And that, actually, that one remark and that little laughter of that girl, you know, a young woman, changes the course of the entire story. Because he pledges to not only shame her, but also deprive the Pandava brothers of everything that they ever had. Are you getting? And now you know the rest of the story. They gamble and then they come. So do you not connect this with all the acid attacks that are happening across India? When do these acid attacks happen? When the ego of the man is hurt. You know, when there is a lot of things like rape happening, or, you know, the gang rapes and so on and so on. When you actually look at any of these stories for that matter, even the groping story that became so famous on the 1st of January, you will find that though people talk about skimpy clothes and women's character, behavior, blah, 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 finally it is about the personal equation between the man and you. She may have said no to him, and his ego will not permit him to accept a no from a lady, and therefore, he will do what he does. Okay. And here you will find that when you look at all these characteristics, even if you are the best of them, even if you have a black belt in karate, not much can be really done. Are you getting the idea? Because you're forced by circumstances. But what do you do in such circumstances? You should arise, you should raise yourself from. The shame is not in the falling. This every one of us should understand. The shame is never in the falling. The shame is when you don't rise up after you fall. And that is when you need all the support and the care that you were talking about. We need people who are understanding, people who around us who will pat on our backs and say, it's okay, things will get better. Because everyone is, and when I say the shame is not in falling, I'm not talking just about women, it can happen to men too. But if you're going to stand back on your shame, hesitate to come up from your shame, you will never come out of it. But when you come out, you should come out positively. Otherwise, you will end up like Draupadi. You know, he got up from his ego brewers. But what did he do? He ended up destroying himself at the end of it all. No point in doing that. So what you should do is constructive coming back. This is very, very, very important. And that is why Malala got her award. Malala is like any other ordinary child everywhere. But why did she become extraordinary? Because she got back from where she was. And if you been, I mean, I'll always recommend, Khalid Husseini is the latest women's, champion of women's causes. Do you read his book? Kite Flyer and the Thousand Splendid Sons, and recently he wrote the, in the Valley, in the mountains echo, you should read them. You know, he is this Afghan writer based in the USA, and he's been writing a lot of books from based in the Afghanistan territory. And they are all women-centric. And I strongly recommend that if you don't have a library in your office, for whatever reason, you know, even if you don't have a library, you should buy these books. The package will come well under 1,000 rupees. You can just buy them, and all of you should read it and pass it on to everyone, your sisters, your cousins, your aunts, anyone. You should definitely read these books, because it's not about Afghanistan, it's about women, and women in Asia can relate very, very well to everything that is happening in India. I'm not talking about the religion or, you know, the country or any such thing. It is the emotion, the EQ kind of equates very well. Every one of us will be able, especially your age group. I'm much older than you. If I can relate, you can relate twice over. Okay, so where were we in the story? Now you find that Draupadi has said the red-lettered, underlined reference to context line of Mahabharata, and then the gambling takes place. And then this woman is subjected to, you know, Yudhishthira loses everything to Duryodhana, including himself. And then this lady asks, you know, then he says, bring Draupadi to the Sabha. And Draupadi doesn't come immediately. She asks a question. Please tell me whether he lost himself first or he lost me first. And apparently, he has lost himself first. So, a man who loses control over himself or independence over himself, how can he even say, like, let us say I sell my bag to someone, to you, and then I have to pay her some money. Can I say, can I take out the purse from my bag? No. That's exactly what he did. He happily gave away Draupadi. Why did he do that? Because he thought he owned her. Are you getting the idea? This is another thing that we do. Across the world, it's not just in India or it's not just in the Asian countries. The men think that they own the women. And therefore, they dictate a lot of things. What you should wear, what you should speak, what you should eat, and so on and so on. And when I talk of owning women, I'm not talking just about husbands or boyfriends. They can be fathers, they can be brothers, they can be your sons. And they think that women are property, you know, with value. And that is why it happens the way it happens, and exactly what happened to Draupadi. And she's shamed, and they are thinking of disrobing her. Tell me, what happens after disrobing? If interference of Krishna and all is a divine thing. But let us look at it as a normal circumstance. The disrobing would have definitely been followed with a rape if it had happened. You know, because the men were so angry with her. And why were they angry with her? Because she was confident. Because she was, you know, she was talented. She was a dedicated wife of, she didn't rebel. She accepted the law of her mother-in-law and accepted the 5 husbands. And tell me what she didn't have. She had a perfect work-life balance. Not that she went anywhere for work via silk board. But, you know, she did do her work, whatever was expected of her. She mothered 5 children. She took care of the husbands in the forest. It's not easy. She cared for them. She did everything, right? And she didn't complain. She didn't say, I come from royal family, so I need my happiness. I need my support. Look at this other wife, Subhadra, who is married by Arjuna. She marries him. The moment she knows this man is going to go to the forest, she's a good lady. She's worshipped in Orissa, in the Puri temple. You have Balabhadra, Subhadra, and Krishna, I mean, Purushottama being worshipped. But she stays back in Dwaraka. It's about you as an individual, not anything else. Okay? And that's what she says. Natamati anata. And the moment she says this, Bhima, he is the only guy whose heart beats for her. among the five men, you know, the reciprocation of love happens only from Bhima, but she doesn't care so much for Bhima. She prefers Arjuna over Bhima. That's another story. That's her personal preference. You can't really say that the equation should always be the same. So what is happening here? Bhima says, you know, I will kill Dushasana, who tried to do this to you, and I will oil your hair, or I will apply this blood to your hair. Till then, you can have your veni out. Your hair should be let loose. Now, this bit about the hair will be all very interesting. There is this lovely play by Narayana Bhatta, written as Veni Samhara. It is about the scene of Draupadi. Veni is the hair. And all of you who come from traditional families must have been told several times by mother or grandmother or somebody saying that don't let your hair loose, right? And then they also say don't cross the threshold, at least. But today, of course, including me, we have all let our hair down. But why? There is a scientific reason for this. But have you noticed that all our gods, both men and women, have nice long hair? They always leave it out. And you will know that hair is made of keratin, you know, and you find that the hair has the, when it is let down, power flows down. That is why they ask us to tie it up. And that is the reason, like, I think any one of us, all of us, including the men, say, or whatever, what we do is, when we have to do some work responsibly, what is the first thing that we do? We tie up our hair, don't we? And you're thinking, how do you do this? Mm-hmm. The men do this. Why? Because we want to stop that energy there. Okay. And that is why. And that is why they keep saying that women should not let their hair down. Are you getting the idea? The idea is to empower you. It is not a silly or a stupid, superstition. And you will find that down south, we always knot the hair at the bottom. You know, even when you, on the days you wash your hair or something like that, the whole idea is to retain the power. And now, women, especially married women, are never supposed to leave their hair down. Basically because the energy is flowing away. And this is one of the reasons during the alankaram of a bride, you have her plaiting the whole hair and you have a kuchu also below to make sure that it doesn't go away. It is planted till the last strand of hair. Veni is very important. And in the same Veni Samharam, he talks about Drona also has his shika open. Because, you know, Drishtadyumna comes and beheads him. He takes off his hair. That's another story. What I'm trying to say is the power of the hair is very, very important. And you find that is why during all the abuses that take place, violence that takes place in homes, especially between the two genders, when the husband beats up the wife or the father beats up the daughter or whatever, you know, when brothers and sisters have fight, the first thing is pull your hair. That's the way a fight begins. Have you noticed? It is an instinctive way, even when small children do it. It is like a survival instinct. You know that the hair pulled means power is going to its way through. To retain, to make the power go, all this. So you find that Draupadi symbolically says, I'm not going to tie this hair up. Now, why are these men, see, she could have walked out of that Hastinapura thing, right? You mean to say she didn't walk out? She did want to. That's what she meant when she said Anathavati. But these men are very quick to make up. Immediately Gandhari comes and she says, I'm so sorry because my children did this. And immediately Dhritarashtra is given a sound scolding by other people. Why don't they want her to go out? Why don't they want her to go out? Think of it practically. I'm not expecting answers. Like, let us say you have a big fight and you say, I'm stepping out of this house, I'm never going to come in again. And then you are convinced to come back home or stay back. What is the reason given by your parents or husbands or?
Family status.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, it will bring shame to the family.
Absolutely. And this is a royal family. You can't have this woman walking out of somebody's life. Isn't it? So they will not allow her to go out. So she can neither stay, she can neither go. She's caught between the devil and the deep sea. So she has to find some way to say, look, I don't like what is happening. And what does she do? She lets her hair down. Are you getting the idea? Some way you should protest. So what I'm trying to say is, look at how, let us say the life when you begin, no, is as large as this whole world. Then it is compounded and compounded and compounded. And finally she has come to this little square. And now she is also put into this little square. And in that square, she is showing her love for freedom. How does she do it? She lets her hair down. Are you getting the idea? So what I'm saying is, nobody is going to give you any of these in a gift wrap. It's not going to be a gift coupon given to you. Okay, Rajeshwari, you wanted this, so you're going to get this. Or Vijaya wanted something, you're going to get it. No. If you want something, you have to get it. You have to work for it. And when you get it, you may or may not get it 100%. But within the given framework, if you are able to do what you're doing, it is. That is why they say, you know, the latest jargon in the world of, what shall we say, management and the world, when we talk about the global village and all that, we say, think globally but work locally. You can think about going to Sweden and Antarctica later on, but only if you work here you will make the money to go there and see all that. Are you getting the idea? So it's always about doing something in the best possible way, so that you can arrive, reach, get. But if you're going to reach for that right now, it's almost impossible. Are you getting the idea? See, look at how Draupadi deals with this situation. Did she have a choice? She had all the power. When you talk about financial power, the whole kingdom was restored to her, isn't it? That's what Dhritarashtra does. He gives back everything and her stupid husband loses everything again. That's a different story. But she had the financial power. Okay, didn't she have a sense of responsibility? Didn't she have self-esteem? Didn't she have freedom? Didn't she receive care? Within double quotes, when Bhima says, I'm going to kill. And then all the brothers stand up behind him, saying that, yes, we will do. Okay, and what about the trust? Nobody, you see, in the Panchamaha Kanyas till today, we consider her to be one of the chastest women ever who lived in the, who lived on this earth. Nobody has, put a question mark over her virtuosity or her character or any such thing. So she had everything. Wasn't she a dedicated wife? Was she not an accomplished woman? She had acquired a lot of skills. That's why she was able to play the role of Sairandiri. You know, the hairdresser in the court of Viracha Maharaja. So she was a very talented woman. She could just cook in the middle of the forest. She had Krishna for a friend, which means she was a great philosopher. And she was a good conversationalist. She knew how to deal with everything. And what about her confidence? She had everything, but she was cornered, and cornered to such a small point. And then the war. Now they are in the forest, and you find that it's not just Duryodhana and company who are after her. You find that Jayadratha, the brother-in-law, covets for her as a woman. So men are constantly looking you up. You stand at the bus stop for more than 10 minutes, you will find that you are being looked at. It doesn't matter what you are wearing or how you look, as long as you are a woman, they want to go on looking at you. It could be anybody. Kichaka wants her. The Kichaka Vadam takes place. You remember in the Virata court, that's where the Kichaka Vadam takes place. And then you find that men are constantly wanting her. There's one Yaksha who wants her when they are in the forest. So you find that this threat. So marriage is not a security against other men not looking at you. It's not about, you know, how many men are brought up on the principle of parastri should not be looked at. Everybody looks at everybody, and especially in a world like this, everyone is. So Doesn't mean you're going to wear a burqa. Doesn't mean you're not going to go out. Doesn't mean you're going to tell every guy that you see, don't look at me. Just go with the flow. To hell with you, when you're wasting your time looking at me, you just have to go. Till you are caught. So you find that the story comes thus far. And then they also have to spend that 1 year in incognito where Kichika gets killed in very mysterious circumstances. And at the end of it all, you find that her husband, Yudhishthira, actually thinks of peace. He tells, why don't we have a peace truce? And he sends Krishna. The Krishna Sandhana is very famous. You know, before every war, there has to be a peace treaty. He goes there and he says, we are going to be very happy even if you give us 5 villages. And Draupadi is very grateful to Duryodhana for not accepting that because she wanted the war. Now, are you looking at it? There are people who say that women are warmongers. They can never forget. They can never forgive. They're very stubborn. Haven't you heard these words? But tell me, was she stubborn? Was she unreasonable? She was most giving. She accepted even the concept of 5 husbands. Being a princess, she lived in the forest. She accepted her husband's decision of losing everything in the game of dice. How long will it take for her to say, like Subhadra, okay, I'll stay back in Hastinapura with my Sasuma. You people go to the forest. She was anyway not involved. She adjusted. She adjusted and adjusted and adjusted till the point where she can adjust no more. And she knows that a war means a lot of things. What does it mean? Death, destruction. Widowhood, possibly. The fact that she was not widowed is a different thing. And the possibility of losing her children, which she does. But she wants to teach a lesson. And now you understand why, whenever there is a horrible crime taking place, the law of the country usually says, okay, death for the man who did this to the woman. In the case of that Abhaya. What's her name? Nirbhaya. Fair enough. You made this woman go through fire and hell. Go through a part of it, at least you let me realize what you have been through. And you find that we live in a country, the Arushi murder, you remember, it's a matter of honor. See, just like Draupadi was not allowed to go away to the forest, you find that Arushi was not allowed to go out of the house also. Parents, doctors, 2014, they killed her. Why? Because the honor of the family is at stake. So where is the question of family caring for you? And in the war, what happens is Ashwatthama tricks her sons, you know, thinks that her sons are her husbands, and when they are lying down under a tree, he axes them to death. Because he has promised to kill the Pandavas. And then when she goes and sees, she finds that they are her 5 sons born of her 5 husbands. And at that time she says, I would have rather had my husbands killed than my children killed. You know, it's one of the, what shall we say, the most poignant lines that can ever come out of a woman's mouth. Especially an Indian woman who always is thinking of dying as a Suhagan and so on and so forth. You find that she's been driven to that point. And at the end of it all, she is crowned. Do you think she enjoys her life as a queen? No, but she is the queen. And why? Work-life balance. Because she can't give up. She has to be there. It is not for power or position or any such thing. And finally, when they go to the Vanaprastha, and they are going towards the Himalayas, you find that there is a lovely story called the Satyaphala story. Just before they go up, there is a fruit which falls off the tree. It's a mango fruit which falls off the tree. And Krishna says, hey, all of you come back here. You know, this is the Satyaphala. And each of you is having a secret. You reveal that secret to me. And then the fruit will go up. So each one comes up with a truth. And Yudhishthira says, so always I keep on saying that I don't want the kingdom. Actually, you know, I need the kingdom. I have always wanted it, but I would just say, I don't need it. And Bhima said, I have always loved Draupadi a lot. But then, she, I don't think she cared enough for me. And Arjuna says, I've never really agreed with what Yudhishthira says, but then I have had to accept. And then you find that Nakula and Sahaja, each one of them has a thing, and the fruit keeps going up, up, up. And then it's Draupadi's turn to talk. She says, no, forget it. And then Krishna says, you have to. You know, otherwise, where is the satya going to be? You have to tell. And then she says, and he says, okay, if it's going to embarrass you to say it in front of everyone, at least tell me so and the fruit so that it can go and attach itself. So she says, look, you know, I have always had this crush on Karna, and I couldn't marry him, and I feel very sorry. But promptly the fruit goes up, and then Krishna asks her, you had an option, he came to this Vaivara, and if I remember right, you were the one who said that he is a Sutaputra and he should not even contest for the thing. Why did you do that? And she says, I had to do it because I didn't want my temptation to overcome me. It's like, we're going to have lunch now, there's a buffet. Okay, and if I'm on a diet, okay, and my favorite sweet is there. So I tell myself, I tell loudly to everyone, look, I'm on a diet, so that I feel ashamed of picking up that sweet in front of you. Are you getting the idea?
Yeah.
That is my psychology. It is actually telling myself, don't eat. But if I don't tell anybody, who will know that I'm on a diet? I can go and eat. But by the way, I'm not. I will eat the sweet. So don't. Okay. So you find that you have to, that's exactly what she did. This is what I meant by Swayamvara. It doesn't matter whom the girl wants to marry, it's all pre-arranged. It is simply called. So, and the fruit goes up, and then when she goes, she is the first one to fall down and die. And life has come to a complete circle. This is not just a story. This is not just a metaphor. It is there in every one of our lives. Every one.